This will be on ammonia. So many insist ammonia could prove to be an important solution in tackling the climate crisis. Indeed, it's been described as a renewable fuel made from sun, air and water. So what is ammonia? Well, it's a naturally produced gas comprised of one nitrogen atom bonded with three hydrogen atoms. The result is NH3, shown here. Today, ammonia is primarily used as fertilizers by farmers, as well as a refrigerant gas and certain washing detergents. These applications aside, ammonia offers an exciting opportunity to transform the energy as well as transport sectors. These are two of the biggest global emitters of greenhouse gas emissions in the world. And we can move toward a truly carbon-free future. As for the here and now, the way ammonia is produced is far from green. The Haber-Bosch process, which is used to synthesize ammonia, is one of the modern world's biggest, dirtiest, and most time-honored industrial processes. It's incredibly carbon intensive and requires a stripping of hydrogen from either natural gas or coal, which during the steam reformation process emits high levels of carbon dioxide. While nitrogen, which is also needed, is easily separated from the air, it's when generating the pressure needed to melt both hydrogen and nitrogen together, which consumes yet more fossil fuels and generates even more CO2. In total, ammonia production consumes about 2% of the world's energy needs and generates 1% of its CO2. So it's not an insignificant amount. Thankfully, greening this production process can be achieved using electrolyzers. Right now, there is a pilot plant in Australia which has halved emissions by feeding power not from natural gas, but a 2.5 megawatt solar array, which splits the water through electrolysis into hydrogen and oxygen. The facility still relies on a Haber-Bosch reaction to combine hydrogen with nitrogen, so it's only a half green solution, but there is a way we could go totally carbon neutral. Douglas McFarlane of Monash University in Melbourne has been working on a fuel cell that directly converts renewable electricity into ammonia. He does this by reverse engineering the traditional fuel cell. So now a traditional fuel cell, it uses the energy stored in chemical bonds to make electricity. McFarlane's device does the reverse. Nitrogen gas and water is inputted and a power cord is directed from a renewable source to supply electricity. As shown in the diagram, water reacts at the anode on the left to make hydrogen ions. These then migrate towards the cathode, where they then react with nitrogen, and together they form ammonia. Zero carbon is emitted throughout the entire process. It's quite frankly genius. The only problem compared to the traditional Haber-Bosch method is it's slower at outputting ammonia. So you may be thinking, okay, great. But why? Why go through this whole process of converting hydrogen into ammonia, only in many cases, for example, the hydrogen fuel cell, to convert it back into hydrogen? And then later on the fuel chain and supply chain and many other applications. Well, simply put, hydrogen is harder to transport. While hydrogen needs to be chilled at minus 253 degrees Celsius, ammonia liquefies at only minus 10 degrees Celsius. At worst, the energy penalty of converting the hydrogen to ammonia and back is roughly the same as chilling hydrogen in the first place. It's also true that existing infrastructure is better suited in transitioning from kerosene to ammonia than kerosene to hydrogen. So this is already happening in Northwest Australia. Australia signed up to export 26 gigawatts of power to Singapore. Instead of linking the two countries via underwater cables, energy will now be exported over the seas, converting electricity to ammonia, shipping the ammonia to Singapore, and being utilised by Singapore as they see fit. It's hoped that this could totally transform Australia's energy and export market, a vision that would see solar farms connected to rigs, which desalinate seawater, use the fresh water to power the electrolyzers, which then produces hydrogen. And then another device would filter the oxygen around it to gather nitrogen. And then finally, you'd use an industrial scale version of Douglas McFarlane's reverse fuel cell, which would knit together hydrogen and nitrogen to produce ammonia, which is then loaded on tankers and exported around the world. Beyond the energy sector, it appears ammonia also has a bright future in transportation, aviation especially. You may have heard a lot about biofuels being the solution to the aviation industry's carbon woes. However, biofuels still deposit carbon in the atmosphere, albeit in smaller amounts than kerosene. There are only two fuels that don't do that, and that is hydrogen and ammonia. The reason ammonia is arguably a better fuel for aviation than hydrogen is because ammonia is much easier to be stored as a liquid. So, for example, ammonia only needs to stay around minus 33 degrees Celsius at cruising altitude, whereas hydrogen must be refrigerated at around minus 253 degrees Celsius in liquid form. As a fuel, ammonia is good at conducting and absorbing heat, meaning you can get a lot of energy out of every drop. And importantly, it can be stored in the wings, much like kerosene, so existing aircraft could be quite easily adapted. It's also less flammable than kerosene, and it doesn't leave behind coke or a residue under extreme temperatures. This also means ammonia acts as a coolant. It absorbs heat as it flows through the engine, thus not dirtying up the internal mechanics. Looking at the graphical depiction shown, I'll try and give a quick rundown of what's actually happening when a plane is fueled by ammonia. So ammonia starts as a liquid in the fuel tank, kept at minus 33 degrees Celsius. It's then pumped for pressurization before heading to the heat exchanger, where it is warmed into a gaseous state. Then it's sent to the catalytic cracking unit, which receives even more heat and is split or cracked into hydrogen and nitrogen molecules. The chemical mix is then ignited in the combustion chamber, which produces thrust, the only emissions being water vapor, nitrogen, and possibly nitrogen oxides, but that can be removed by using more ammonia. So the only real drawback is it is heavier relative to kerosene. So an increased payload will thus mean increasing the amount of energy needed to expend en route, which ultimately diminishes the range of the aircraft. So a purely green ammonia aircraft will likely only work for shorter haul flights, by which I mean across Europe, mainland United States, a lot of Asia as well. So this brings us on to the final topic, which is fuel cell efficiency. Naturally, you want it to be as efficient as possible to increase the range of the ammonia-fueled aircraft. If you look at this graph displayed, you can see what a difference a 10% improvement in efficiency makes. So for instance, a 60% efficient fuel cell at 1 kilowatt per kilogram provides an aircraft with 4,000 kilometers in range, while 70%, just a 10% improvement, delivers a range of almost 7,000 at 1 kilogram, a kilowatt per kilogram. So, in sum, ammonia has huge potential for the energy and transport sectors, with today's innovations, particularly Douglas MacFarlane's reverse fuel cell, we could see ammonia become the unlikely hero in solving our climate crisis. Thank you very much.